Hi there, Queensland storyteller. I'm Kim Dodsworth. Two good mates are facing one of life's milestones. The end of primary school years and carefree days. High school beckons. Both sense a parting of the ways. One boy is an achiever, the other an average student. The latter feels impending loss of his friend, and he's taking it hard. The story is Slowly Last Summer by Peter Goldsworthy. It's from The Best Australian Short Stories 2007, published by Black Ink. Universe, Milky Way, Solar System, Earth, Southern Hemisphere, Australia, South Australia, the Southeast, Pinetown, Church Street, 32. I always scribbled my galactic address backwards on my things. It seemed to offer a more logical pathway home if something found itself lost, especially in another galaxy. I flipped my new 28-inch bike upside down and carved the same sequence into the rawhide underbelly of the saddle. Although if that beautiful machine, a Christmas reward as top boy at the end of primary school, loved me as much as I loved it, it would surely have come freewheeling home riderless whenever I whistled. I suppose I was always happy, if mostly of a kind of even, steady happiness that largely escaped my notice then. Happiness was a default state, a given, like the town that I was born in, the family I was born into, like the mind that I grew into, the brain I'd slowly begun to fill. Summer was another given, a recurring given. Billy Curry was also a given. We'd been best friends since he first moved to town, a lifetime, a child's boundless lifetime, before. It was arranged friendship, like most from childhood, a match made by geography and limited opportunity. We'd shared the same desk throughout primary school. We went to the same church. Reverend Stevenson had helped sponsor the various Curry families when they made the move into town from the mission. We played in the same Caledonian band, me on pipes, Billy on kettle. We both had stick-thin bodies with big, difficult-to-balance heads and even bigger mouths that were forever getting us into trouble. We were both expected to get into trouble, me because I had a cop for a father, Billy because he was an abbo. He inherited my 26-inch Morven Star that Christmas after a lengthy bargaining process. My dad, who saw himself as some sort of local protector or benefactor of Aborigines, offered the old bike for free. Billy's dad, a proud man who worked plenty of overtime at the sawmill, didn't want charity. Somehow a price was agreed on. Money went one way and the bike went the other in a terse, wordless ceremony outside the front gate of the station. I overheard the liturgy later that night, a muffled whispering behind my parents' bedroom door. Not as if they don't need the money. You'd think they'd be grateful. You've done so much for those people, Bob. In our boy world, both bikes were common boy property. Bare-chested and barefoot, but with thickly brill-creamed hair, Billy and I rode everywhere that summer, rode to the ends of the known world, or at least to the ends of our endurance, whichever came first. Apart from the occasional ride by mealtime or comb through of fresh brill cream after a weekly shower, we were seldom at home that summer. Once or twice we camped in the depths of the forest, if only to terrify ourselves, but there were no rabbits there, and rabbits were our subsistence crop, worth $4 a brace at Jeffrey's butchery. Farmers everywhere welcomed us and directed us to the biggest warrens and best campsites. Short, sweet nights these, at the end of long, exhausting days. After setting our traps, we'd light a fire, lay out our blanket rolls, and smoke pilfered tailor-mades or pungent rollies of newspaper and palm-crumbled stringy bark. Probably the first freshly skinned rabbit would be roasting on a rough twig spit between us, and with luck, there'd be something to drink. Perhaps a bottle of autumn brown sweet sherry that Billy had filched from his Uncle Doug, who lived on its pungent brown mother's milk. More traps would be springing shut in the darkness about us, more rabbits crying to be released, if only from pain. But very soon we would have eaten too much meat and drunk too much sherry to move or even to stay awake. "Tell us another science fiction story," Billy might mumble across this sleepy twilight zone. Tell me the one about the planet where the people grow wheels instead of legs. Four wheels. The people have two wheels, I remind him, like bikes. They're a kind of centaur. It's a really flat planet. All the other animals have four wheels. Same diff, tell it again. I was always happy to tell it again. I was happy to tell all my stories again, although usually one of us would be asleep before I finished. What if we're not in the same class at high school? He shook me awake on another night towards the end of summer, perhaps even the same night. Giddy and barely sensible, I couldn't move. What on earth was the time, at least on this corner of Earth? Halfway to morning and then some. The fire was dead, the moon and stars all shifted and strange. Huey said they'd done this test on the first day, last year. Next day they put everyone in a different class. Go back to sleep, Billy. Can't sleep. What are we going to do if we're in a different class? We won't be in a different class. He rolled across onto my swag and jammed a headlock on me. You'll be in the brainy class for sure. Let go, bugger. You're brainy enough. You know more than me about lots of stuff. His grip was a vice. I'm dumb. Everyone knows I'm dumb. I'll be in the dumb class. What stuff? He had been in this half-tearful, half-violent state before. Sweet Sherry especially could get him started on everything that might go wrong with his life, or had gone wrong since leaving the mission, and an idyllic childhood of swan-egging and fishing and messing about in boats. That tiger snake we killed at the dump, I remembered. You knew how to skin it. Open sesame. He released the headlock. Course I knew. We used to eat 'em back on the mission. I didn't fully believe him. That is, I believed that a curry uncle or cousin had probably eaten a snake somewhere, some time back, but not Billy. He hadn't wanted to eat our tiger snake. What do they taste like? Like fish. Mullet. A bit muddy. I grabbed a king brown by the tail once, I told him. He didn't really believe that either. But we didn't have to believe each other, especially this late at night. The story was the thing, whether set in the future or the even more astounding past, and now he needed to hear the rest. Soon enough he was asleep, but I couldn't follow. My neck hurt a little. Billy's affectionate violence often left me sore. And although the giddiness of the sherry had faded, nausea remained. I slipped out of my blanket roll, took a long purifying piss out into the darkness, then grabbed my torch and knife and wandered off to check the traps. Rabbits might be a plague, but they shouldn't be left to suffer, according to my old man. Or left. His old man was a Scot, after all, to work their 2-bob carcass free, or drag a 10-bob trap down a burrow from where it would have to be dug out. Less hunter than gatherer tonight, I twisted 2 rabbit necks, slit open their bellies by torchlight, and flung the guts between my legs far out into the darkness. A 4-bob night already. I didn't bother resetting the traps. I emptied the last of the autumn brown into my big chipped enamel mug and stoked up the fire. High school was suddenly no more than a few days away. Would we end up in the same class, or even, the root cause of Billy's panic, I see now, in the same friendship? Time would tell. Far more interesting to me that night was the promise of high school itself, growing closer with each less small hour. I liked school. I was good at it. I played up from time to time, played the smart aleck, but unlike every other boy my age, I couldn't make myself pretend to hate it. Billy slept on. I stirred the embers and picked over the rabbit bones and sipped at my mug. Alone in my default happiness, in my default corner of the big default universe. That summer night is 40 years past now, but the sting of eucalyptus smoke in my eyes and the ruffle of the night breeze in my hair feels as fresh and new and vivid as ever. Pinewood, South Australia, might have been the width of a paddock or the width of a galaxy away, no matter. In the morning our 2 bikes would find their way home easily enough. Bedrolls and skinned carcasses and rattling traps strapped to their wheel racks, the 2 of us half asleep in our saddles, our long morning shadows pacing us, neck and neck, flat shadow centaurs of boy flesh and steel tubing and spinning wheels made one. I hope you enjoyed Suddenly Last Summer by Peter Goldsworthy. I'm Kim Dodsworth. Thank you.